the first one. Okay, so there's a few bits to talk about before we get started, really. This lecture that we're having on a Thursday night, Thursday evening, that's not so night, that's evening, from 5 until 7, is going to be in LF15. Okay? It's not going to be in here because there's some central timetabling schnappu. So it's going to be in LF15 down in the student area country next to student support. The other thing is, so how many people went to the gallery last week? Okay, cool. I noticed that some visiting students didn't go, very bad. So how many people went to the curry afterwards? Oh, now was this and that a cool, a top place? You didn't like it? Come on, you freak. It's great. Okay, well, here's the thing.
Dodgy curry place down the back of a dodgy alley.
No.
Do you want popcorn? No. Popcorn? Do you want
three curries, three days? Sorry, like I was having a discussion with Marina, and Marina thought it was three curries for £3. I was like, no, it's three curries for £3. It was one curry.
It wasn't really three curries for £3. It was one curry, one meat, and then two vegetables.
Yeah, so it was like.
Yeah, and Marina thought you get three curries for
£3. She's tired, so yes.
Jeremy, could you eat more afterwards?
I know.
So we're good. That's good. Okay, well, I'll say this and that. I'm now the mayor of this and that on Four Square, just to let you know. Okay, so the gallery visit, you're going to get a questionnaire about it anyway, but who thought it, just so I can give some quick feedback to the gallery people, who thought it was useful and who thought it wasn't useful? Okay, so who thought it was useful? Okay, and who thought it wasn't useful for the people who went? You're always there, curmudgeon. Okay, that's good. Fair enough. Now, I'm not giving the notes out yet because I don't want you to be all freaking out, okay, because there's a few. So, the notes. So we've got notes for this time, which are here, okay? So these are the notes for this lecture. Get them out. Oh, I'm really spread out. There's not a computer scientist, aren't you? Good. Okay, well, I'm too lazy to be bothered with this. Okay, now, along with these notes, you're going to get the notes for Thursday as well, okay? Just in case you decide you're not going to come and you're going to look at the video recording instead. I shouldn't have said that, because now it's going to be me in for 2 hours, but now we go. Now we're all community people at the back there, so that's good. Now, you've also got an appendix, which you don't have to read, about why Zen and the art of motorcycle maintenance is good for teaching user experience. It might give you some ideas, even if you just look at the section headings where it talks about things like perception of user experience and collision of two opposing ideologies. Okay. Also, there's a reference to there. If anybody wants to get it, there's a free version of Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, which is searchable, and it's online at Caltech. I don't know how Caltech have got away with it, but it seems a bit dodgy to me, but anyway, there's a reference to it in there, so it's free if you want it.
Is that a free text version?
Yeah. Now, for your notes for Thursday, there's another annex, which is about an extension to this, well, just discussing more about ethics and why we've got them. So in the notes, you've just got the most basic, it's not that basic, but the most basic thing you need to do for ethics, okay? Why we've got them, etc., and what we should be thinking about for research ethics. But actually, there's more to it than that, so if you want to read this, on research ethics, on why we've actually got ethics, why we were created, why we call people participants and not subjects, then there we are. And finally,
enjoy the scene.
I'm loving it. You can't tell me that you don't get complete notes. Now, this is for week. You know now that we're not here in week. What it will be week 10. Yeah? Because we're doing this lecture tomorrow night. Because I'm at the lab conference next week now, isn't it? So I'm giving you week 10 notes now, just in case you want to read them over the Easter vacation. Okay? You might not want to read them over the experience next year in the vacation, but there we are. I told you you'd be scared if I just left the room in the break and such a
oh, yeah. Right?
We're going to look, has everybody got over the shock of all these notes yet? Yes?
Can I ask a question? Are we going to have a revision lecture that's
just
looking
yes. And you weren't at the gallery last week either, were you? No. So if you'd been at the gallery last week, you would have heard me say, we're going to have a revision lecture, at which point you'd need to email me. So we get the last lecture we do, which might be a double or a single based on how many comments I get, will be a revision lecture, okay? So what that, in that revision lecture, you need to send me anything at all you want me to cover again by email. And then I'll build the lecture out of that, out of the stuff I get back from you guys, yeah? So instead of me telling you, yeah, here's a revision lecture, but I'm just going to build, you need to tell me what it is you don't understand, or what it is you want more information on, okay? I would be you'd be safe in realising that if you can do the self-assessment questions, then you're going to be good to go for the exam, yeah? Okay, so that's the main revision, that's the self-assessment questions. But we will be doing a revision lecture for 2 hours, or 1 hour, based on whatever it is you might, you know, based on how many emails I get back. Yeah. We'll squish it in somehow. We've got statistical analysis to do with that. And we've got some notes on real life development. But real life development, you don't have to freak out about, they're just notes because you've already had that lecture. It was the BBC lecture that we gave you week three. You know, sorry, yeah. Week two, lecture three extra. Yeah, so you don't need to worry about that. But we have got the statistical analysis one is the one I want us to look at. Okay? Not necessarily because there's going to be anything to do with statistics at this point on your... In fact, I'll tell you now, there's going to be nothing to do with statistics on your exam. This year. That's for the camera. This year, there's going to be nothing on statistics. But for your year, if you're not this year, then there might be. Yeah? Okay? So 2012, in the exam, I haven't put any statistical questions, just because they're right near the end, and we needed a bit more time to actually look into it, I think. But it is, there will be two lectures on statistical analysis. You should be coming, you should be here for it. If you don't turn up, then you're just stupid. So, we'll be watching a nice TV show as well for 40 minutes on the back called The Art of Statistics, which is a very good motivator, and then we'll be getting into the often misconceptions around statistics that people have. Like, for instance, this result is more significant than this next result. Who's done any statistics? Good. Okay, so this result is more statistically is more significant than this result. Have you heard that? And what does it mean? It means that one is much more significant than the other. No! That's not what it means! See? You've been taught wrong. That's not what it means. Anyway, we'll get to that in the semester report. That's a book there. Okay, let's go on to this. Right, obviously, if you want the website, you know where the website's going to be, and you know you can take a photo of it using the QR codes. Right, upwards. Who's read? Obviously, the people who didn't come to the gallery didn't get the gallery lecture which I gave for an hour on the scientific experience. It's a shame on you. But I'm sure you've read the notes and you all know what's going on. So, why don't you know if the effective principles have been captured in the software correctly? Let's talk about that. Who wants to tell me? Yes?
They're difficult to isolate in testing.
They're difficult to isolate in testing?
Your software. So if you can test one of the principles, and it's difficult to capture the user's response.
Okay, so why is that? What is it about the effects of experience that makes it difficult?
You have to monitor the user's emotional responses, which could be a combination, or is a response to a combination of the different principles. You can't just test one if it's there.
Yeah, okay, that's good. Any more? Yes?
They vary so much from different from person to person, and each person relates to a particular piece of software in a different way to someone else.
Okay, so these ones are subjective as opposed to the other ones which are more objective.
Yeah.
So this is the thing with user experience. This division between the objective and the subjective, this smushing together, is the thing that really defines the user experience from, say, standard HCI or usability, yeah, and accessibility. It's this coming together of intangibles, which is in the subjective stuff. Why is effective computing different to effective experiences? Oh, who was that? So I'm going to pick people who were actually listening to my lecture last week. Obviously, nobody was. Anybody? Yes?
Computing is all about a computer having emotions, whereas the effective experience is all about the user having emotions and experiences.
Yes, that's very good. That's the definition. So the difference is, effective experience is about the user's emotional experience interacting with the software system, whereas effective computing is the work about computers understanding and then having emotions, centered mainly in coalesce mainly around Rosalind Picard's group at MIT. Okay? Okay, now, what can we take from Rosalind Picard's group, from the work that they do there? What things can we take to help us understand better our effective experiences? What kind of devices might we use? Anybody who's there? What devices did we mention? What kind of metrics might we use? Biometrics. Geez. Come on! Switch on! Biometrics is what we're going to use, right? So biometrics we can use. So things like, what kind of things, what kind of biometric stuff exists that we were talking about?
Pupil dilation.
Pupil dilation. That's a good one. Any more? Galvanic skin response. Yes, any more? Heart rate monitor, excellent, yes, absolutely. Okay, so these kind of biometrics are used to try and understand the emotions of people so that then computers can understand them. But what we can use them for is use them so that we can understand the experience a bit more in our study. Now obviously you've got contention with galvanic skin response, for instance, because it can show excitement as well as it can show stress. Okay, they're very similar. So you don't quite know what's going on there. So tell me about excitement. Do we want the experience to be as massively exciting as is humanly possible, or do we not want it to be as massively exciting as is humanly possible?
No, there's up to a point and then the performance goes down.
Yeah, there's up to a point and then the performance goes down, yeah? And what's that called? What's that curve called? Any ideas?
No.
It looks like a standard bell curve, that's true. Looks like a standard distribution. But it's actually called a Yerkes-Dodson curve. Okay? And that one that you saw last week is the Hebden version. Yeah? That's the Yerkes-Dodson curve against performance against arousal. Okay. What other graph did we have there that we talked about? Yes?
We talked about one that talks about the challenge and challenge against the level of boredom that people want?
Skill level.
Yeah, skill
yeah.
level.
So it's the flow graph is the skill level. So we've got skill level against challenge, and you get boredom at the bottom and anxiety at the top, and then there's a band in the middle. Okay, so that's also what we need to be thinking about. How do aesthetics and visual complexity relate to each other?
Well,
These are all self-assessment questions which we want to revise. Okay, we'll skip that. How does narrative art to relate to the principle of flow? Okay, I think we'll skip that. You can do that yourselves. And number five, why is emotion difficult to quantify? What is one possible solution? Well, we've done that. We've said it's difficult to quantify because it's objective and it's about biometrics. That's one solution to it. Okay, you can look at biometrics. Okay, so let's look at dynamic experience. And what do I mean by dynamic experience? Well, for me, I mean the interplay between people, really, the dynamics between people. Now, we could say this is all about a topic called gamification, which we'll get onto. But actually, it comes out of other things, which is more about social dynamics. It's about phonology, which is another bizarre wording, but anyway, phonology and gamification wrapped up together. Okay, so we're going to look at these in a bit more detail. Now, active, potent, energetic. Okay, that's the kind of thing that comes over when we speak to people, when they're talking mainly what, if they're talking about this in the outside world, not in this lecture theatre, not in, say, academia, they'll be talking mainly only about gamification. Yeah? I don't think that's the whole story, so that's why I'm telling you about the chronology and the other stuff. But they're going to be saying, yeah, the gamification is about this active, potent, energetic force, yeah, that you're using, for good or ill. Now, I used to be quite dismissive of gamification. I'm still not completely convinced, okay? And so I used to call it digital umami. So digital deliciousness, it's just like sprinkles, kind of. You know, who knows why it's there, you stick it on, it makes it all active, makes things happen on the screen, and then people are into it, okay? We talked about the principle of personality last week with Ming's cars, and she's using ridiculous, you know, paintball gun sort of animations and stuff to make her things more dynamic and active, and this is the same in some ways. So I just thought that it's kind of this, you know, it's not really there, it's not really deep, it's digital mind. Now I was having this argument with a guy who works for Google actually in their UX department called Rui Lopez, and we had some not argument, but discussion about whether it really was deep or not, whether gamification was really deep. And at that point, I was saying it's just crap, and it takes more time. At this point, I'm saying it's not. There might be something there, okay. But I don't think it's as deep as people want it to be. I think actually there's an economic reason why people want it to be deep in the games industry because it gives them another outlet for their skill set. Yeah. Okay, but it'll be up to you guys to decide. You might think, oh, that Simon Harper's just an old dinosaur, don't know what he's talking about, whereas this is the new stuff. Yeah? Okay. So, here we are. Pro-Marmy. Okay? So who say, as the critics point out, some gamified products are just poorly executed. So that's one thing you need to think of. There are different levels of gamification, including things which are called bolt-ons. So these bolt-ons, it's just like you think, ooh, what would be good in a game situation? Bolt it on. Okay, to anything. It'll do. It'll be great. Just because you saw something in the game once doesn't mean anything. But I think that most of the critics of gamification fail to take into account the wide range of execution that's possible. Gamification can be applied as a superficial afterthought, or as useful or even fundamental integration. Now this might be true. I don't know whether it's fundamental, but it might very well be useful. Possibly, in the right circumstances, I'd say. Okay. Now, the cons, the people who don't like it, gamification is invented by consultants as a means to capture the wild, covert beast that is video games and to domesticate it for use in grey, hopeless wastelands of big business. Wow, I just love this quote. That's the kind of quote I like. I'm a Ted Nelson kind of guy. It gives vice presidents and brand managers comfort. They're doing it right. And there's some truth in it. You know, that's exactly it. Some people do think that it's just, hey, we'll make our horrible corporate crap really exciting by slapping the super colourful games kind of stuff on it. Yeah, that's it. And we can sell it then to the vice presidents because, hey, we know what we're doing, we're the software engineers. And the brand managers love it because, hey, it makes their dull crap look better. But still, in the interaction, it's dull crap. Okay? Now, you know what? These are two extremes. I think it's somewhere in the middle, as with everything, or most things in life. I think it's these are two extremes and there's a balance to be had. But, you know, some of you might go out into the world and then you decide you're gamification people. You know, you do gamification. You very well maybe needing to get into companies where you're doing this stuff. So it might be useful. Has anybody done any sort of contract work or done anything based on gamification? Any kind of integration at all? Some of you guys think do outside stuff, no? Okay, well, I mean, it might be, as I say, I think it's useful to know that it's there. How much you believe it is up to you. Need to get an opinion on it, okay? And that opinion can be modified. But for me, I'm in the middle. I don't think it's the answer to everything. This one has far more resonance with me. I think a lot of the time it's for big brand managers to just go, yeah, this is just a horrible app, yeah?
I'm just wondering, so is gamification basically trying to put kind of a more fun feel to the work that you're doing?
Yes, so we'll get onto that, but things like, for instance, things like, say, league tables. So, for instance, there's talk of league tables, that if you have like a little, on your barcode scanner where you're pricing products in the supermarket, if you have a little thing that registers how many products you've priced, you can see how well you're doing against all the other people pricing those products. So you do faster, because you want to, maybe not better, but faster, because it's fun, because you want to win and be higher on the leaderboard. You can also say there's things like, for instance, dovetailing into the stuff we did with sort of studies where people said the reason why they made changes to their energy consumption wasn't because of all the good work it would be, you know, that it would be environmentally friendly, it's because what their neighbours did, yeah, what they were told their neighbours did. Now, there's also stuff that dovetails into that sort of thing, so that therefore, you know, you're looking at what other people are doing, yeah? And you're pushed along this route to try and, so for instance, there's some social network apps where they want to take all your data. And so if you just give the basic amount of data, it says, your data is 23% complete, but your friend's data is 100% complete, which implies you're crap, kind of. Or implies you need to give us all your data so you're as good as your friend's 100% complete data, because we all want to be 100% complete. Yeah? That's the idea of it. We always want to get to the end of the game, get to the end of this level. So it's set out like this. Yeah? Okay. So let's have a look at the social dynamics aspects in a little bit more detail before we go on to the phonology and the gamification stuff. Now, the social dynamics aspects is what it's trying to do. We know that collaboration with users, with other people in the network, makes you more effective. We know this from pair programming. We know it from older users are less hesitant in the choices that they make if they're sitting with another person, because they can collaborate together on it. We know this from collaboration, for lots of different kinds of collaborations. We know this from focus groups, where focus groups, you might get more rich information sometimes from focus groups because there's a herd of people there. We know this from the knowledge of the wisdom of the crowd, kind of, if there is such a thing. Okay? So what we're thinking about doing with this social dynamics stuff is to say that our interactions are more pleasurable if we feel we've got support, if we feel we've got backup, if we can do jobs together in tandem, in parallel, okay, as pairs, we're feeling that, and we also feel that our jobs are, or that the tasks we're supposed to be doing may take longer, so usability-wise, they may be a lot longer, okay, to do. But that's not the case for the perception of the experience by the user, yeah? Because if you're talking with someone, so that you're both doing your task together, the task might take longer, but it might be more correct, say. Or the task might take longer, but your perception of the time might be less, because you're having a good time talking to the person you're doing it with, you're both doing it together, you feel secure. Yeah? So that's the idea of this kind of social dynamics aspects. Now sometimes, that's not the case, and sometimes it can be difficult for software engineers to realise that. You know, a lot of software engineers like to do the thing on their own. It's their view, it's their vision, they do their thing. Don't want to talk to anybody, please, etc. Okay. Others, other user groups, actually want that collaborative, communal feeling. Yeah. The people you're designing for are often probably not going to be software engineers. If you are designing for people who are software engineers, then you should go and look. You should go and look at a resource called PeakPig. So PeakPig is the psychology of programming interest group. Okay, so they have lots of stuff on the psychology of programming and how programmers work, as opposed to differences between programmers, software engineers, and maybe other user groups. So it's called PeakPig.org, I think, or something. So, other things which are intangible and might seem kind of, it even feels in some way a bit weird to me to be telling you about this, because it feels a bit like I'm some kind of long-haired hippie sort of thing, where I'm talking about the energy that is often found in human interactions, okay? Kind of weird. But, I think there is energy in human interactions. There is something, you know, we do have friends, we do live in, you know, large groups of people, even if we only have a few friends, we do have them. Yeah. There is some energy in conversation in talking about it. Propels to having better user experiences because they are closer to the expectations of person-to-person interactions. Now this is interesting, because what happens is that there's been lots of studies just in psychology and cognitive psychology and cognitive science actually about our expectations or users' expectations of the tools that they're using, especially software engineering tools. Okay, not software engineering tools, tools that were created from the software engineering process. So software tools. They expect the software tool, even though it's a software tool, to conform to the social principles that they expect from their everyday life. Okay? It's bizarre. I don't know why. But they kind of add on to it this kind of... they humanify, if you like, the interface. They make the interface more humane in some way. So people expect the interactions they're having to be with other people in that surroundings to be the same as they're having with the computer. And they get frustrated if they don't get those. I suppose it's in some ways you could feel like it's how we as humans have a tendency to humanise everything. So cats, dogs, animals, you know, all this kind of stuff. I was looking at a website last night called Cats That Look Like Hitler. Okay, and they're called Kitler, apparently. And so, but they don't look like Hitler. They're cats. How can they look like Hitler? But, you know, there we are. We want to make them look more as though they're more human, more sort of... so that we can empathise with them better, I suppose. Yeah, I don't know why, but we do. It's the same with the artefacts we have. Yeah. We feel more secure and more likely to perform better within groups. This is well-known word in psychology, okay, in sociology. Group work, people like it better. I mean, when you're doing your... Oh, yeah, you've all done your third-year projects, and then you've also done your group projects. Which did you prefer? Who preferred? I have a tendency to do that. Which do you prefer? Not really a question. Did you prefer group projects? Put your hands up. Who preferred group projects? Well, that just proved me right. You're all software engineers. You just got to deal with social interaction.
Yeah, was it because you didn't prefer those particular group projects? With some useless students, or
good point. Yes, that's very true. Although, unfortunately, in the world of work, you're going to have to get used to the useless ones.
I think it was at the group project we just got all the people that we didn't have a choice of who we were with.
That's true in work. Yeah, that's true. But I mean, some of these things are right though, because in work you won't get a choice of who you get put within a project team. I mean, you get some real, people. And the same is true. And the same is true for
real people.
Well, I'm using that as a sarcastic. Not sure whether they are people. And you also get, you get people who are just there for the ride. They're not interested in doing anything too. So there's some reality in that. But yeah, it's if you got the choice, would you rather work alone or in a group? In a group. Who said in a group? I'd rather work in a group. Okay? And who'd work alone? 1, 2, 3. Okay, 4, okay. So, okay, yeah.
I found that industry. Then it was much better working in a team. And obviously, it's not realistic to work on your own in that environment. Because obviously, then you've got like people with like 20 years' experience and you're working alongside them, so you can obviously progress a lot quicker.
Yeah.
And so you learn a hell of a lot just from working alongside those kind of people.
That's true.
Even if there are a few that bring the team down, generally it averages out above the because you've got the better people pulling it up.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, also, there is a big stick in you know, in industry, because obviously they'll just buy you. So if you're not, if you're not performing, then you're going to get sacked, whereas at uni, you know, difficult. But there is, you know, lots of people feel better, feel like they do, I mean, users perform better in big groups, or in groups, anyway. That's why we put together small teams, I mean, that's what we're about. Okay. Take advantage of expectations of performance to social and cultural norms. We've already just covered this, actually, so this is something that you'll need to think about as well. Okay, so this social conventions. Remember we spoke previously about using blue hyperlinks when the web first was created, and the fact that people didn't like to select them in Japan, because blue is a bad colour. So, you know, those kind of things, those cultural norms are still there for the software engineering process. Okay, so, facilitate social dynamics. Now, I really like, has anybody seen this Microsoft Courier tablet? Okay, yeah, so some people have seen it. Got canned because it was good, probably, and Microsoft don't like to do that. So, it got canned because it was really, really a nice tablet. But this, the main point of this was to facilitate social dynamics, okay? So, it looks nice. I mean, they had working versions, so they weren't just prototypes that were just graphics. They had working versions, and the versions that were created were mostly created by designers, kind of like a design notebook might be. And so what they could do is easily share with people who they were interacting with, sometimes on a remote basis, but what really happened is they really liked it when they were in a small team working environment. They had something like a picture or something they'd cut from the net or cut from somewhere on their pad, and you could just flick it across to the person who you want to flick it to, okay? So, I'm not sure how that worked, but generally, the idea was that if you came within proximity, you can then flick across something, you can then communicate between the two machines quite close. Now, of course, they used to do that with Java ring business cards. So, in the old days, you used to have Java was supposed to be embedded everywhere, and we have these little Java rings, if you went to the Java conference. We also had a Java kettle. You know, you've seen Java. Anyway, so they had a Java ring, and in that ring they'd encode your business card. So when you went and shook hands with somebody, the two rings would be in close contact, and they'd exchange the business cards because you'd shake them hands. So therefore, it was an easy job to do. We don't have those now, particularly, but anyway, it was about this embedded Java to be able to do this. All of that kind of personal interaction and the way that it's facilitated implicitly is kind of useful. And this is what was going on in this social dynamics experiment that they were doing in Microsoft. Now, so wedded were the 100 or so developers at their Skunk Works at Pioneer Studios there in Seattle to this, that as soon as they decided to can it, the head honcho, whose name I've forgotten now, just resigned, and the whole staff just got reintegrated back into Microsoft. Okay. So this is now gone. But it was an excellent, I mean, all of the feedback that they got from the users, all of the feedback that they had from the public was that this was a really nice way of doing things. It doesn't look frightening. It looks, you know, it looks very sort of, well, not too corporate. Okay? And also the interaction between other people with those tablets when they come close was really nice. Okay, so, another kind of social dynamics we'll get onto in a bit more detail. So we've seen these. Anybody who's not familiar with Cockney rhyming slang can see this now. Fast sausage and mash, fast cash. Okay, that's the Cockney rhyming plan. So if you want fast cash, you want fast sausage and mash. So this was obviously put there so that it would gain some sort of, you know, people would go to see it and they'd take their money out to see this kind of Cockney rhyming slang. It was geolocated to London, so therefore it wasn't just everywhere. And of course this cash machine is one of those that charges you £1.25, so they're trying to get more people to come and take money out of here just to see this, interact with this kind of thing. But it's kind of a social dynamic because it says I'm part of Cockney culture, or I like Cockney culture in some way. I understand socially what these things mean. Okay? Same as people who are maybe Red Dwarf fans can. There's some social dynamic going on there as well. So here you've got 30, 40, double top. You know, various terms, comedy terms, I don't know, it's like around 10, 1 of 20 did 30 do the top 40. Top 40?
Darts.
Huh?
Darts.
Darts, okay.
20 did the top.
Okay, fair enough. Does it drive them? No, very weird. Anyway, there we are. So this is the kind of stuff that you can do to facilitate social dynamics and phonology as well. Phonology. Now, phonology was is a concept which was really created maybe 15 years ago, and I think a lot of the gamification stuff comes from this kind of phonology stuff. But it was created, yeah, about 15 years ago, I'm not talking about 10 years ago possibly, maybe a bit less. Okay, and certainly the phonology term was coined about that time. There was an initial upsurge in this phonology, with books being published on phonology, and then it all went quiet. I think it's been because it was difficult to see how it could work practically. It was mainly in the academic domain. Gamification is mainly in the software engineering domain. So one of these is really about kind of from a research domain, the other one is from a practice domain. Okay? So that's why you probably haven't heard each of this phonology particularly. So the things I've highlighted with the various aspects that you should be thinking of or that are proposed with phonology. Personalisation, we've seen this before, so we've seen that personalisation is useful. And here the main thing is that decision making authority of the user. So instead of you getting, so that even though the user might be making an incorrect decision, you think, you might want to let them do it because it gives them more sense of accomplishment and achievement when they complete it correctly. Okay? Don't think labels, think expressiveness and identity. Okay? So these keywords are very difficult to, in any way, think about testably. Okay? But this identity thing, expressiveness and identity are very useful, especially in industrial design domains where we're thinking, say, of, like I keep going back to, the iPod, where, you know, there's not many people who are queuing up for nobody's, for example, queuing up for hours outside of a Sony shop for their Sony Walkman, but there was for iPods, okay? Because you're buying into this, expressiveness and identity. If you had the white cord that goes up to an iPod was completely novel when it was created. Everything was white cords. So therefore you're saying, I'm an iPod user. In Manchester at that time, it wasn't a good idea because everybody knew you'd got a very expensive MP3 player in your pocket and there was lots of space of iPod snatching. Okay? But the same is true for these, I'm old, aren't I? Is it Beats, Dr. Dre, Audio, doohickey things where they've got this red cord and everybody knows it's white and silver and red kind of thing? So that sort of shows that you're buying into some kind of identity. So I suppose that the Dr. Dre things, because they're quite expensive, they're expensive and they're a bit DJ-y, so I'm kind of a music DJ dude, possibly. Yeah? Intangible. So I've highlighted here, don't think ease of use, I think enjoyment of the experience, and I think that's quite a useful thing to be thinking of. Okay. But sensory richness is also something you need to think about, especially when we're moving from designing software interfaces to interfaces on devices. Yeah. Tangible. Don't hide, don't represent, show. Okay. Now, in some ways, this conflicts. Why does it conflict with stuff we've been doing in usability?
One of the things that we talked about was having some form of hierarchy where you don't display every form of functionality. So in this case, it's saying don't hide, don't represent, whereas we talked about putting it into a form of hierarchy where hide certain functionality is unnecessary as such, maybe.
Yeah, that's very true. Any more? So represent. We use metaphor a lot in usability. Yeah? But that's a representation of non-reality. It doesn't exist in the software interface, it's just a metaphor. So it's a representation. So we're not showing directly. Yeah? We're trying to say this is kind of like what you do in the real world. But it isn't. Okay. Narrative. Possibility to create one's own story or ritual. Why is this important? Why is narrative important? Well, Creating one's own story or ritual is useful because the ritual binds us together in groups, for a start, because we have this shared ritual. Yeah. And the second thing with regard to the narrative is that we know that narrative is a far more effective way of conveying lessons, say, and information, than is just dry wall of text, like these textbooks that you've got. Okay, that's just textbooks, that's just text. But if you, say for instance, if you read any of the religious texts, you read the Bible, it doesn't just say, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. It gives you a narrative, which in the end says, do this. Yeah? Or if you don't do this, it's all going to be told. Yeah? That's the kind of thing that we're talking about here. Narrative, it's easy to convey the meaning, oftentimes. But it does make it, what does narrative normally make things? If you create these kind of stories, these kind of narratives, what is introduced as opposed to just bullet point, do this, do this, do this? Yes? You have a choice to do it or not to do it, that's true. So what does that introduce?
It creates like a mental image or something you relate to.
Yeah, it creates a mental image. Makes it into a game. What negatively do you think it introduces? Ambiguity. So it introduces ambiguity in a narrative because you can then interpret that narrative to mean lots of different things. Yeah. So therefore, if you've got ambiguity introduced, then you know it's not exactly necessarily straightforward. Further, if you've got lots of words surrounding the story, how do I know that you're getting, not the story, but the point, the principle, how do I know that you're understanding that this thing here is the thing I want you to learn, as opposed to just having a nice reading the story? Yeah, there's a lot of surrounding text that builds you into that. So that's a downside too. Metaphor. Metaphors does not suck. I don't know why it says sucks. Okay, it's either my typo or their typo. Anyway, yeah, probably my typo. Metaphor does not suck. I've left that blank because I'm not sure. We see that previously, lots of people say that metaphor does suck, but it's not very good to use. Other people say that it's a good idea. Don't know. What do you think? Who thinks metaphor's good? Ah, who thinks metaphor's bad? Why do you think it's bad?
Because it holds back the experience. If we're tied to having to design something around some metaphor, pre-existing metaphor, then we're always held back from the innovating.
Good. Excellent. Yeah, that's very good. That's very true. You could have been at my lecture last week, actually, because that's a very simple thing. Very good. Okay. Same as familiarity with an interface holds back innovation, because if you're trying to be familiar, how can you be familiar yet still innovative? Communal. Social opportunities. This connectivity is very important. You'll hear this spoken about a lot. Okay. Especially this bit here. Connectivity is something that you'll hear outside in programming circles, in user circles. Doing things together, this connectivity idea. So generally, doing things together seems to be a good idea at this point. Okay? People want you to be doing things together so that you can do them more efficiently, or spoken about. Which leads back to, as well it being fun, it leads back to the point on social interaction, social dynamics. Learning, repetition and progress. So, this is something that we also have to do. We have to do it with most stuff. Okay, so there needs to be some repetition in what you're doing, but it needs to be a repetition that maybe you don't know you're getting. So, in a fun way, we need to facilitate the learning process a bit better than maybe we're doing with regard to the interfaces that you're creating, or that we are creating. Now, phonology. Here's an example of a fun thing that we can see. So what's fun about this? It's a Dropbox, but what's fun about it? Yes?
Grab a Snickers.
Okay? There's a long time left for these 37 to answer, might as well grab Snickers. Now randomly it could put anything up there, I suppose. It could even be advertising. In the evil phonology gamified world, that could be advertising that Snickers have paid for. Theoretically. But it's there, so it kind of makes it a bit more fun. Yeah? If you mean it. That's the intention anyway. So cocktail. Handbrake. Put down the cocktail. Okay? There's no reason to tell me that. There's no reason to say that. but it just does it because it's like, why am I? Because it's told me that it's going to take a while to rip this open, convert a file from one to the other. And so it says, go for another cocktail. Why, I don't know. Because it's called Handbrake. I don't know, somebody does. But it's just like that. Now, how would you, as software engineers, could make this better? Very simple. This thing here, how could you make it better? Just with the cocktail, when it's done, it says, do the cocktail. Oh, we'll put that cocktail down before it starts, actually. Before it starts, it says, go and get a cocktail, and then it starts to do its thing. How could you make that better, more fun, maybe, for a user?
Give it some recipes.
Give it some recipes, okay? So you can give it recipes for cocktails that would just randomly, fill up. Why not? Okay, and of course we've seen the Cockney ATM. I've got a different one here. Bad picture, but please enter your Huckleberry Finn PIN. Please enter your Huckleberry Finn PIN into the... please enter your ATM. I don't write these, I don't make this up. Okay. So gamification is this thing we've been talking about, really, that we've been getting for. It's been the elephant in the room for the last hour or 50 minutes. Okay. So there's different kinds of gamification. So we've got this elementary thing. So we've got visual elements like badges, cute phraseology, these things that you might see in gameplay. If you wanted to dovetail into certain kinds of gameplayers say, you might use terms or jargon they're familiar with from certain games you'd expect them to play. So, whatever's the most fashionable game at the moment, I don't play games. What's the most fashionable game at the moment? It's about to be something that's when you get shot, isn't it? Don't know. No game players here? No? Nobody plays computer games?
It's great. There's a zillion different answers.
A zillion different answers. Okay, well, what's your answer? Okay, so you can have phraseology that people might dovetail into. You can also, in the real world, you can have cute phraseology that they might dovetail into as part of their sort of work tribe, if it's a work, if it's a work group. So for instance, the people who were into this user experience and were doing it and were working mostly around Pioneer Studios when they for Microsoft. These guys used to be called, when they all got dispersed, they called themselves the tribe, okay, when they went. Because they still felt very close to the Skunkworks, this kind of innovative Skunkworks that Microsoft did, but they were now they were like the diaspora, okay, all over the place. But they still wanted to think of themselves as one, okay, for some reason. And that's the same student, you can then tie into that kind of terminology, that kind of language. So you'll be using language say for instance you use language in situations where you have meetings with people, which you might use phrases and jargon, not necessarily because you want to use that phrase or jargon, but because it ties you to other people in that particular group, and two, it allows you to see who isn't in that group. Okay, it's like a shibboleth. Yeah? It allows you to see who's not part of that group. So therefore I use the term the other day, LAMP, to see whether anybody understood what the hell I was talking about in a management meeting. One person did out of seven terms, so now we know they know something a bit more than the other people in the technical development, and then you can have a conversation possibly. Okay, but that's something that is there in this sort of shared jargon in an interface. Same is true with the Cockney writing slang, it's a shared jargon. Then we have bolt-on stuff. So the bolt-on stuff like this, set of game elements which are more deeply related to games and gameplay. They're easier to add to the pre-existing games, so that's why they're called bolt-ons, but they can be done really, really badly, okay? You can really go for this kind of, oh, it's a great piece of stuff, bolt it on and my assistant associate president, whatever they are, will really love me, yeah? In a really bad way. But things like progress and reward, okay? So you're going to get a reward for progress. You're going to get so many special points to for progress. Leaderboards. Who's in the lead? Okay, these leaderboards. Who's in the lead with buying stuff, with viewing stuff? You can see this. There's some outdoor manufacturers who have leaderboards for buying stuff. Who's bought the most stuff today or this week? Yeah. So you can buy more and be a leader. Me? I am just as bad. And this bolt-on crap. Well, maybe not the bolt-on crap. Maybe I'm ground up. But me? I'm the mayor of this and that. Why? Because I go along to this and that, go, ooh, ooh, press foursquare. Yes, log me in. And then I go, yeah. That only took me 10 times to come here, and I beat the guy who was the mayor before me. Yeah, there's no reason for that, I don't think. Apart from my geeky nature, I'm allowed to say I'm the leader, I'm the mayor of... Although, Foursquare has added extra functionality, so therefore you can get discounts at various pubs. If you're the mayor of various pubs, you get 20% discounts, things like that. So, you know, here we've got this progress and reward aspect, right there. Okay. And this is really a bolt-on for Foursquare, because they didn't really create it like that. They created it so you could just geolocate. And then there was, how do we make a business model out of this geolocation? More people who say that they're present in your pub, say, at a certain time. That's good if they show it, show their screen to you, and you give them a discount. Yeah? So it's like a loyalty card in some ways. And then game elements which were planned from the start and invisible from the main development, indivisible from the main development. So, I looked around for this ground-up stuff, and I can't see it. I can't see anything more than visual elements, like aesthetic visual elements. I can't see real gameplay, just things that visually look like games, but the interaction themselves isn't. So if anybody can find something like this, let me know, because I can't. That looks like it's ground up. Yeah? And does and isn't a game. Actually does, you know, something. Okay, so here's an example of gamification. You can put yours at thinggeek.com, a great store, of course. You can put two stickers all over the world. Okay, so why would you want to do this? It just takes you more time. I don't know, but you can. So that's part of this gamification, okay? You entered in a random monthly $100 ThinkGeek gift certificate draw. So they're only giving you a gift certificate, so, you know, still, they're making money out of you, really, kind of, if you get paid. So it's kind of a prize draw, in some cases, by you adding your little button to their map. Okay? Another one. The amazing Tinny. Gosh, ThinkGeek's Tinny is great. So it asks you a question. Is there a six Cylon, who should it have been? And then here you make it, you click, who should it be? It presumes you know something, obviously, about... Battlestar Galactica. That's where it assumes. And then you decide your fate. So what is this? Why is this gamified? Well, I mean, obviously, you can see it's gamified, but give me an example of one of these that isn't gamified. It might be a bit of phonology, but... Why, give me an example of one that isn't gamification. So, on Google, oh, Malcolm, just a bit, you can see me, just about 6 minutes.
No, I was wondering another one, I'm not sure what
okay.
This category is.
Okay, this thing here, what do you think this does? It looks like a fortune teller, it ties into a fortune teller, so it's fun. It's a little game. Because you can just do these clicks, but what purpose does it have for them? All it does is take, don't look at the notes. it takes you to a random product that you can then buy. That's all it does. Okay, so how is it similar to, I mean this is gamified, but say on Google where it says, oh, you know, I'm feeling lucky or whatever it might be, just give me whatever. You know? It's the same thing, it's just simple, it didn't do anything. But it just makes, it's just like, oh, it's a game, yeah, this is great. We'll do choose President Brosnan and, oh, just randomly go to a...
Does it randomly assign you to a product on the press or design? Yeah, those three options lead to three different products all the time.
They don't lead to the same three different products all the time. So they do lead to three different products, but it's each one is just random, but it's, they're not the same. Yeah. You'd have thought that they could build something in. To do that, so it might say, oh, I'm interested in something, so that'll be it. But no, it's going to be just fun. And another one, Boeing's new airplane site. So here, they have this scrolling 360-degree sort of scroll of different sort of their different airplanes, which can then you can then zoom in, zoom out of, and this kind of stuff. Now, this is just like standard visual. It looks, when you see it, it looks visually a bit like it could be the start of a game, okay? But it obviously isn't, because it's, you know, how likely is it we're going to buy one of these? Based on this. You know, good psychology is something to do, I suppose. Okay, so after this break, which we're going to have in a minute, I want to know your views. What do you think about gamification? That's the first thing. So when you're outside getting coffee or doing whatever you're doing, talk to each other and see what you think about gamification. Okay? Do you think it's, from what you've read in your notes, from where we've got to, from me spouting, what do you think about it? Do you think it's a good thing, a force for good, a force for evil? Okay? All right, so coffee time. Back in 10 minutes, 9:17 minutes here is 8 minutes past 12 today. Okay?
Just a test, because it works with what we're recycling. Basically, yeah, the more recycling we can get on this hanger, and the more genuine you can be in the point of coverage. And it's a high score as well.
And can it's you see it?
There's video of it, they recorded it. Because they've got to see a camera in there to see what they're doing. And yeah, literally, people go in there like at night and just like, the camera is recycling it, and they're apparently like a week, and then they feel like,
so I mean that ties in to lots of the stuff we've been talking about, not just on gamification, but chronology and social dynamics,
yeah.
Therefore we're involved in a group.
Obviously crowds were like ranks and hitting noises and it's flashing and there's like high score and stuff, so it's definitely telling cool stuff.
system. Moving bolts to the afterwards, or its main functionality is this. We don't really care about our games until later on, we've got this up here on top. So it's not really, it'd be nice if there was an answer that says yes, this is a different game. I mean, what do you think about the software? Do you think it's a game? Or do you think it was recycling game for it, or do you think it was a game?
They want the media to perceive it as recycling game.
Yes.
But ultimately, I think they developed an innovative game, and then it was like, well, how can we apply this to humanitarian cause or something?
Yeah. Yes. So I think that's the problem. It's
but also, the media they want to perceive it as a game. It's like, right, we will create this.
Yeah. So I think that, and I think that when you see this in the long term, you can tell if it's a game, I think, if it's just a game, or if it's continued, if it's on the team. So does it finish? So if it finishes, then it's a game in some way, because like, for instance, selling cans of beans. And that's gamifying something. But if it's not, if it finishes at a certain point and so, for instance, things that didn't recycle, does it stop after a month? So if the game's done, it's a game. But if they keep recycling, you could allow it to divide itself by its emergence, but then if it finishes, it can obviously just get more long. If it doesn't finish, then the gamification works. Because it doesn't work. The gamification doesn't work if it doesn't finish. It's just one shot there for recycling.
Yeah.
So that's why it could be more difficult to understand what it is.
But isn't something like Forspring then? Example of growing up because they built it as a game and then they created that model afterwards.
Yes.
So see, that's
yes, kind of. I mean, I'm not sure whether it's built as a game or whether it's built as a recommended system. So, or some kind of social networking system whereby, I check into a place, you're walking by, you see I'm checked in, we haven't finished meeting, and you come in and say, oh, maybe I'll check the deal or something. So, and then they've added a bit of the mayor and all this to create the business model that will allow them to sell it on stock or whatever. Because that's where the advertisers are. So I'm not sure. It's difficult to see. It feels to me more like when you see the evolution, it feels more like a battle. Because the evolution is it started off as a social system where we could find out where they are.
Yeah.
Now maybe there's some game elements in there because those game elements were more about you sort of saying, oh, I'm in a cool place to really pay, it's a different place, but it's really talked about. Maybe game elements that facilitate social interaction, social networking. Whether it was Game Frankenstein, I'm not sure whether that was in their original topic. And again, maybe you have to make that call. I think that maybe. The definition, I mean, we look at the definition which seems to be generally accepted of the game of
evolution.
That might not be. These definitions might not be good, don't they? We might say, well, actually, it's all based on this one. We're going to make it less rigorous because you can never quite tell.
Right. And on the pilot terms, for the main principles, policy, is that your opinion or is that general?
No.
Because I don't really agree with them sharing they represent.
Yeah.
They don't hide them represent sharing.
Yeah.
Because ultimately people do use the
representation of the
Those
books there were created from reading a set of books in the context, and then you see what people come up, what they're sort of laws are. But So generally, it's the
Thank you.